Hi, welcome all. This is Meghala Anandakumar. So in this section, I am going to present my project on fraud reduction. This project is focusing on fraud reduction in online credit card transaction. So I have considered the credit card data available in Gaggle. The scope of my project is developing both supervised learning models and unsupervised learning models. I have built a dense layer feed-forward neural network, and I have developed autoencoder and self-organizing map. Here is the software and hardware requirement for this project. I have used Jupyter Notebook, and I have installed TensorFlow and Keras. Apart from that, I have installed all other supporting libraries for this project. Here is the data. The author of this data actually transformed most of the variables into PCA components. The variable V1 to V28 are PCA transformed variables, and they have added the original variable time and amount. In addition, they have added the variable class, which is actually telling whether the transaction is a fraud or not. In this data, each row indicate the transaction detail. The size of the data is 150 MB. It contains around 284K records. So I did some descriptive analysis of my data. I actually did a correlation plot, and I have developed a scatter plot and density plot. And this correlation plot shows that there is no significant correlation among the independent variables. And when I look at the scatter plot and density plot, I understood that the variables cannot linearly separable based on the class. That means whether it is a fraud or non-fraud cannot be identified by just looking at one variables. So it clearly indicates that we really need a robust model to identify the fraud. This is the dense layer feedforward network that I built. I have used 4 hidden layers and 1 output layer. I used sigmoidal function at the output layer and ReLU function in my hidden layers. I trained my model for 100 epochs. I kept the batch size 32. After training, I observed the training and validation loss, training and validation accuracy, and I did hyperparameter tuning. I tuned my L2 regularizer parameters. I defined 3 different L2 regularizer parameters, and I observed the loss and accuracy for all 3 regularizers. And when I look at that loss and accuracy, I found that there is no significant difference based on the regularizing parameters. And I did k-fold cross validation to understand the consistency of the model. I kept 7 folds, and I ran my model all on all those k-folds, and observed again the accuracy and loss with respect to each fold. And these plots, that means this box plot as well as another line chart, which indicates that this chart is actually based on the mean and standard deviation of the scores, accuracy score and validation score. This indicates that performance of the model is good across all 7 folds. And the loss plot is also showing that the model is performing well across all the folds. And I actually observed a different type of performance metrics. I looked at the ROC value. The AUC value of this ROC curves is coming around 0.96, which indicates the model is really performing well on predicting the fraud. And I looked at the recall versus precision, and I observed the change of recall with respect to different threshold values, and I came up with this scatter plot. Here In this scatter plot, the red line indicates the prediction probability threshold, which is kept at 0.5, which classify these two classes, fraud and non-fraud class, based on this threshold. This clearly indicates that this value, that probability of on the prediction probability is really classifying both the classes. Very good. And I looked at the confusion matrix, and the confusion matrix indicates that model is performing good on predicting true positive and true negative. And that means predicting fraud transaction as well as non-fraud transaction. And after that, I developed my autoencoder model. In my autoencoder model, I kept two encoders and two decoders. I have used both TANH and ReLU functions in my model. So this autoencoder model is a kind of semi-supervised algorithm in which we really don't have the target variable. I used the input variable as an output variable to train this model. This autoencoder would try to reconstruct the same input data. So while training process, I removed all the transaction which is considered as a fraud. That means all fraud transactions from the input data is removed, and only transaction which was not a fraud are given as an input to this model and trained, and the reconstruction error is minimized. After training, when I give the new data, it's actually a fraud data, the reconstruction error would be high. So that is the indicating parameter to identify whether the transaction is fraud or not. I kept the threshold value of 0.004 on the reconstruction error. When the reconstruction error is beyond this value, then it is considered as a fraud transaction. And here also I observed the similar metrics, that means training and validation loss during my training process. And I did regularization hyperparameter tuning on my L2 regularizers, and I did k-fold cross-validation. Here is my self-organizing map. This is the architecture of my self-organizing map. The size of this map is 600. That means it has 600 neurons. And number of iteration, I kept it as 40, and alpha value, that is learning rate of this network, is 0.5, and I kept the sigma value as max of mn divided by 2. The sigma value is the radius that helps to identify the neighborhood neuron from the best matching neuron corresponding to a given training. So maybe when one neuron, for example, this neuron is considered as the best matching neuron, based on the sigma value, the remaining neurons closer to this ones are considered to update its weights. The way in which the SVM works is different than other neural networks. Even in this architecture, there is no concept of layers. And here in this network, it has only the matrix of neurons, and all the neurons has a vector of weights. The vector of weights would represent the input data. During the training process, actually the weight vector of each neuron would be trying to match against the input data. So the weight would get adjusted such that it would represent the input data. So after training process, I just looked at the weight distance of each neuron corresponding to the neighborhood neuron. That would indicate whether the given neuron is an outlier or not. So I plotted this graph. This graph is drawn based on the weight distance of each neuron. When the weight distance if a particular neuron is very high corresponding to its neighborhood neuron, then its value would be very high, and very high values are represented by very light color in this graph, and which indicates these are the outliers. Then the mapping input vectors corresponding to those outlier neurons are considered as the fraud transaction. And these are the fraud transaction identified by this model. And just to understand the underlying pattern in the transaction, I plotted this graph. These graphs are based on the PCA values. That means I reduced the dimension of the weight vectors of all the neurons, and then I used the first principal component to draw this map, and I used the first three principal components to draw this map. And it shows that there is some pattern existing in the transaction. And I compared all these three models, and I looked at the ACU value. And ACU value shows that these two models, dense layer feed forward and autoencoder model, these two models are working very well on performing well on predicting the fraud transaction. I looked at the AUC value of SOM model, which has the value of 0.89, which is not very bad. But I didn't have much time to fine tune my SOM model, which was taking so long time compared to the remaining two models for training. So maybe I hope that I can spend more time on this SOM to improve the performance by fine tuning the model parameters. And here is the comparison of these three models based on confusion matrix, and this indicates the percentage of true negative and true positive predicted by all these three models are really good, and percentage of true positive is also high, more than 70. A lesson learned. A lesson learned from this project is that we can experiment with different supervised and unsupervised models for this problem, that we can confidently and successfully implement either dense layer feedforward network, or we can implement this autoencoder or SVM for this problem. And future work, we can leverage all these three models by including the distance information. Here the distance information means the distance between the location of the transaction and the location of the customers. By adding that information, we can improve the current model, and we can explore LSTM model by considering the time series data. Here the time series data means instead of considering each transaction as a record, we can consider the sequence of transaction made by a single customer. So we can study set of customers and the sequence of transaction made by each customer by using LSTM model. So here are the list of references I have used for this study, and I have added my short video and long video link here. Thank you.